Hi everyone, I am Dr. Radhika Narendra Barde, a second year radiology resident at VKL Walawalkar Rural Medical College and Hospital Ratnagiri. The study that I shall be discussing today is cartilaginous syndrome, a radiological perspective. So this case came to us in the month of September. A 39-year-old unmarried female, known case of situs inversus, presented with chief complaints of shortness of breath and frequent episodes of lower respiratory tract infections throughout her life. The surgical history included pulmonary lobectomy done in childhood. No family history of situs inversus, bronchiectasis or sinusitis was present. The investigations performed were chest X-ray, a high-resolution CT thorax, CT of the paranasal sinuses, contrast-enhanced CT and ultrasound of abdomen and pelvis. The chest X-ray findings revealed a right-sided cardiac apex and a right-sided aortic arch indicative of dextrocardia, a left-sided stomach bubble, hyperinflated lung fields, flattened domes of diaphragm, and resection of a sixth rib on the right side consistent with history of lobectomy. On high-resolution CT of thorax, we see hyperinflated lung fields with emphysematous changes in both lower lobes. Significant cystic and tubular bronchiectatic changes are seen in the left lower lobe, and tubular bronchiectatic changes are seen in the right lower lobe. Inspissated mucus plugs are seen in few of the dilated airways, giving it a classic finger and glove appearance. Multiple centrilobular nodules are seen scattered bilaterally. Collapse consolidation involving the posterior and medial basal segments of the left lower lobe are seen with few dilated air bronchograms with it. Another interesting finding was that of a multiloculated, multiseptated cystic lesions within the superior mediastinum in the left paratracheal location. There's a communication seen at 5 o'clock position with the trachea, suggestive of tracheal diverticulum. Another finding was that of a dilated thoracic esophagus. Here we can see dextrocardia with reversed positions of the great vessels, a right-sided aortic arch and pulmonary artery, along with left-sided superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, and a zygous vein. On ultrasound, we can see reversal of the position of great vessels with the IVC being on left and aorta on the right. There's also reversal of the position of superior mesenteric vein, which is on the left, and superior mesenteric artery, which is on the right. Another finding was that of a midline liver extending in bilateral hypochondriac regions, along with mild hepatomegaly, and polysplenia in the left hypochondriac region. CT of the paranasal sinuses revealed hypoplastic sinuses and bilateral maxillary sphenoid and frontal sinusitis. A relatively hypoplastic middle nasal turbinate is seen here. Coming to the diagnosis, so our patient presented with history of frequent colds, chronic cough with expectoration, and recurrent pulmonary infections presenting from early childhood. The radiological findings in our case are dextrocardia with situs inversus, bronchiectasis, bronchoceles, central lobular nodules, pansinusitis and hypoplastic paranasal sinuses, tracheal diverticulum, midline liver, and polysplenia. So a diagnosis of cartilaginous syndrome was made based on the clinical presentation and imaging features. Cartilaginous syndrome is an autosomal recessive genetic disorder, a subset of primary ciliary dyskinesia, characterized by a triad of bronchiectasis, paranasal sinusitis, and situs inversus totalis. The estimated incidence is 1 in 30,000 live births. Male-female ratio is 1:1. A gene mutation at DNA I1 and DNA H5 leads to impaired ciliary motility and mucociliary clearance. This predisposes the patient to recurrent sinopulmonary infections, infertility, and errors with left-right body orientation. Coming to features of cartilaginous syndrome, bronchiectasis in patients of cartilaginous syndrome is an acquired condition. It results in airflow limitation, obstruction, and impaired clearance of secretions, leading to repeated respiratory infections. Chronic bronchitis, bronchiolitis, and emphysema are often associated with bronchiectasis. The second finding was that of central lobular nodules and bronchoceles in both lower lobes as a result of superadded secondary infection. Acquired tracheal diverticulum is due to increased intraluminal pressure and weakened tracheal wall resulting from chronic cough, bronchitis, bronchiectasis, emphysema, and recurrent respiratory infections. Pansinusitis occurs in almost 100% patients of cartilaginous syndrome, which results from accumulation of secretions inside the paranasal sinuses, eventually leading to hypoplasia or agenesis of paranasal sinuses. Dextrocardia with situs inversus is present in nearly 50% patients of primary ciliary dyskinesia. This immediately raises the suspicion of a genetic disorder with multi-organ involvement in patients, since it's a very uncommon radiological finding. Another finding in our patient was that of midline liver and polysplenia, which again is a rare coincidence in cartilaginous syndrome. A diagnosis is based on patient's history and radiological findings, that is X-ray, CT, and ultrasound, which can further be confirmed by genetic testing. So, following the diagnosis, goals of management are improvement of the lung function and limitation of the disease progression. The treatment strategy includes aggressive antibiotic therapy, prophylactic immunization, strong pulmonary toilet, regular physiotherapy, and in patients with recurrent pneumonias and hemoptysis, we advise segmental lung resection or lobectomy. So, to conclude, early diagnosis and symptomatic treatment, as well as prevention of the infections, is important in patients of cartilaginous syndrome. Granting access to proper diagnostics and referral to a higher center is necessary. These are my references. Thank you.